Paula is the recipient of prestigious fellowships from YADO, the McDowell Colony, the Cleveland Art Prize, the Ohio Arts Council, and the National Endowment for the Arts. She is also the author of two collections of poetry, a memoir called Like Family, Growing Up in Other People's Houses, and a first novel, A Ticket to Ride. She lives with her family in Cleveland. We are thrilled that she's brought her latest novel with her tonight. Now please welcome Paula McLain and guest host Benjamin Bush.
Thank you so much for coming back.
I'm delighted. You all look amazing. Hello.
I look better in the dark, too. Let's talk about everything that you've been doing in language. And I want to start with the fact that you came from poetry, as Doug said, which is an interesting move, you know, of all things to pick in literature, the one that focuses most entirely upon every single word. You shave away every single extra thing to have just the purest pieces of language to express the largest things. How did you choose poetry first? How did you find your way to language from your life?
You know, I don't think that I chose poetry. I think it chose me, because honestly, I was writing it as a kid before I knew what it was, before I read poetry. Granted, it was pretty internal and deeply private, a way to make sense of some of the trauma I was experiencing. I didn't share it with anyone, but I was always writing it. I mean, from the time I was like 7 and 8 years old.
Do you still have those poems?
I wish I did, actually. And then, and I don't know how I got sort of the cheek to do this, but I was in a grocery store line when I was about 19 years old and looking through a Cosmopolitan magazine, you know, the sort of naughty ones up by the by the register. And at that time, Cosmopolitan published poetry. And I just thought, I'm going to send a poem to Cosmopolitan magazine. And I did, and they took it, and they sent me a check for $25, which I was so excited about, in fact. I almost couldn't cash it, because what it meant was I was a writer. Powerful to have an identity to kind of cling to and push against.
And your first actual published writing as a collection was Lessifer in 1999, your first poetry collection. You went directly from that and switched gears into prose. Nonfiction prose, no less, with Like Family, which was a memoir of your journey through the houses that you had grown up in as a foster child. Mm-hmm. How did that happen? How did you move from verse to story?
All of it was a surprise to me. You know, when I was in graduate school at the University of Michigan, my teachers told me it would take 5 years to publish a collection of poetry, and I was ready. Like, you know, I was like gonna jot my time down and in a log and do my 5 years. And so almost immediately after I started sending out the collection, I got a call one night. It was like Friday night. I was teaching at a boarding school in Vermont, and it was an editor out of Kalamazoo, Michigan, at Western Michigan University, saying that he had read my book and he wanted to publish it. I just sat there with like my mouth open on the phone, like, it can't possibly happen this way. A, it's happening too quickly. B, it's way too easy. C, it's been like 2 months, not 5 years. The time has not passed. And the other thing was like, do I have to, you know, like pose naked or something? Like, what is going on here?
It's not cosmopolitan.
It's not cosmopolitan. Western Michigan doesn't have quite the glamour of cosmopolitan or the dirty pictures. But and after that, so when I was still at Michigan, in fact, I began having conversations with some of my fellow writers, and memoir was really big then. You know, Mary Carr had just published The Liars Club, and Tobias Wolff had just published This Boy's Life. I mean, extraordinary, extraordinary books. And when I would describe my background, invariably people would say, you should be writing a memoir. And my answer for that was always, well, you know I don't write in sentences, right? Like, how would I get there? But I was really intrigued by the challenge of it. Like, I couldn't really fail because I was clueless. I was clueless. My standards were so low. And that's ultimately, I think, why I was able to write that book.
You failed upwards into a memoir?
I failed upwards, right.
And that's still a very personal book to you. That's still kind of your first big child. I don't hear you talk much about less of her as much as you do Like Family. What was different about what you explored in Like Family than what you had been exploring in verse? Did all those same ideas come up in poetry?
Absolutely, the same ideas were coming up in poetry. But I write like very short lyric verse, super elliptical. There's a poetry word. Meaning you can't make heads or tails of it, right? It's a total puzzle.
You don't
puzzle.
Use that in a book proposal, I found out.
Yeah, elliptical, enigmatic, that's another one. I was telling the stories of my childhood, but in a very occluded way, in puzzles, making small poems that were expressing the feeling of my experience without actually telling the story of my experience. And the greatest surprise of sitting down to write a memoir scene by scene, and again, as I said, completely ignorant about what I was actually tackling, was how much fun it was to tell stories. I had no idea what pleasure that would bring, simply confronting a moment, describing something. Just the first moment, for instance, we might have arrived at a new home, you know, the smell of the grass and the sprinklers and dogs and roses and facial expressions. And there was more pleasure in my childhood than I knew, which I didn't know until I began describing it.
It's interesting. Did you go back to the homes that you had been in to research or relive those, or did you go entirely out of your mind?
What are you saying, Ben?
Did you go crazy writing this book?
Well, just a little bit. No, I didn't do any research. What I did was simply let myself remember. And memory is so stinking interesting to me. It really is. Memory is really interesting because sometimes I would try to lunge for a detail because, of course, we're supposed to like describe it in such a way that somebody feels like they're there, like, right? But honestly, when you're writing memoir about something that happened when you were 8 years old or 4 years old or 6 years old, et cetera, it's difficult to remember those things. And so occasionally, don't tell, I made stuff up. I made stuff up, like what I was wearing, or I described in one scene a Mickey Mouse watch with like a teeter-totter back and forth, because it was what came to me as I was writing a scene. And when my younger sister read a draft of the material, she's like, oh my God, I forgot all about that Mickey Mouse teeter-totter watch.
They're real.
I hadn't made it up at all. And that's, I think, one of the fascinating things about memory is that we can be surprised by our own attachment to images and bits of language that kind of resurface when they need to and can surprise us in pretty extraordinary and delightful ways.
And then you went right back to poetry with Stumble Gorgeous.
Yeah.
Like 3 or 4 years later was your next book.
Yes, I think it's, you know, I was teaching poetry. I was teaching poetry at a low residency MFA program.
Poison's our best.
Excuse me?
It poisons our best. You know, teaching poetry.
Poetry poisons our best, right. Since I was reading so much poetry, I was still writing it. Mm-hmm. I've gotten it completely out of my system. I'm sure you'll all be relieved, but yeah.
Have you?
Maybe, I think so.
You don't ever write a few lines of verse when you're just kind of
kicking around?
in the moment, driving, you're like, huh, that's perfect.
No.
I should put that in my ideas undone file somewhere.
No, I think what happened along the way was that, and this is going to sound slightly odd and maybe a little egomaniacal, which is not it at all. Poetry became a little too easy for me, and I don't mean like I'm a genius, I've taken it as far as I can possibly go, I might as well quit now. not that at all, but the size of a poem, that it was a manageable thing, that I could see it all on any given day. I could see the whole poem. It was a file. I could move the words around almost like a puzzle. And a novel is vast. It contains multitudes. It's like throwing words into the Grand Canyon, right? And so when you have a document on your desktop from a that's a novel, like you can't see the end of it and you can't see the beginning of it and you have absolutely no idea where you are. And I have a novelist friend who says, writing a novel is like being a blind, naked mole rat, you know? And it's like that every single time you write a novel, and somewhere along the line you learn to like it. And that's what's happened to me. I sort of really like the feeling of being completely over my head. Hmm. It's messed up. It's a little messed up.
How did that move you into Ticket to Ride, which was your first novel?
Well, I mean, it was sort of like the same. This is the theme. Ignorance is the theme. Ignorance and challenges that are beyond me. I had never written a memoir. I'd never written sentences. I somehow managed to write that book, and lo and behold, found a New York agent and found a publisher and went on the Today Show when it was extraordinary. I didn't sell copies. That wasn't in the deal, but. And then I decided I would write a novel simply because I had never done that before. Now, it's never occurred to me to say to run a marathon because I had never done that before, but.
Never fought any sharks?
I've never fought sharks.
Yeah.
No,
so
but
there's other
it could
things
still,
to do.
There are other things to do. It could still happen. But I liked that in fiction, in the novel, in that form, anything could happen to anyone at any time.
It's the best kind of memoir. You can make the
at
whole
all.
Thing up.
In fact, yes. Now I find that idea terrifying, that you can write about anything that happens to anyone at any time period. Seems like it's too permissive to me.
But that's exactly the next thing that you did with The Paris Wife.
Mm.
You went into someone who existed in the world and inhabited them. How was that? How did you begin to divide yourself from Hadley, the young wife of Hemingway living in Paris?
How did I divide myself, or how did I find her?
Well, first, how did you find her, and then how hard was it to get her out of
here? I'm not sure I've given her up. She might still be around. The book idea, and I've talked about this quite a bit, was really a fluke. Ticket to Ride, as well as the memoir, sort of didn't sell, and along the way I lost two publishers who kicked me out of the nest because I wasn't selling books. It's a pesky little problem, you know, that you actually have to sell the books in order for them to continue to invite you to the dance. It's a pesky problem.
Yeah, I've heard about that.
What's that?
Weird rumor going around.
So I was desperately searching for an idea for a second novel, and I kept pitching my agent, you know, what about a novel set in a tourist cave in Arizona where a dead Mormon girl pops up? And I did pitch that book. I did pitch that book, to which she said, oh, please, God. Oh, please, God, do not write that book. I'm so glad she said that. And anyway, quite by chance, I got my hands on a copy of Ernest Hemingway's memoir from his early days in Paris, A Movable Feast. It was a bit of Hemingway I had never discovered before. And Paris in the 1920s, like, what's more delicious than that? I had never heard of his first wife, Hadley Richardson, and I became instantly fascinated by her and the story that she might have to tell. And instantly obsessed, and once I had the idea, I never looked back. I never sort of looked in the mirror and said, oh my God, you're about to write a historical novel. Like, what could you possibly know about doing that? There's going to be research, and then there's going to be research, like real research, and a lot of, you know, that sensation of being over my head. I just went in, you know? I just did it, and I went looking for biographies, and I discovered that, in fact, she was quite a remarkable woman. And she wrote great letters. and I found a cache of love letters that she and Ernest wrote not long after they met at a party in Chicago in 1920, thousands of pages of love letters. And so I had her voice, and that was the string, you know, that was the thing that allowed me to have the confidence to believe I could follow this woman, like, down the rabbit hole and out into 1922 Paris, into Gertrude Stein's salon, and to think I could understand what she was thinking and feeling. But I believed it. Like, I believed that in some way I had attached to her something, her... This is going to make me sound a little bit wacko. I'm from California, so don't... We're all a little bit that way. I felt like I understood something about her, and I could write in her voice and her consciousness. So I never asked myself, like, whether I would write it in the third person or the first person. I just immediately started using the first person voice so that it immediately became like a fictional memoir. I had no idea what I was doing. I was just going on instinct.
How much of that was left over from you writing your own memoir? Was there some echo of I still being present as a writer that you then took into just consuming Hadley as yourself?
Interesting. I think I was conscious of a desire to break down the barriers, you know, the distance, the psychological distance between myself and this woman that I was getting to know and sort of falling head over heels in love with her world and her point of view. But you know what, I also think the poetry is in there too. Because as a poet, I was writing a lot of dramatic monologue. Sometimes, like in my second collection of poetry, I take on various consciousnesses and monsters and animals. And I know it sounds a little bit freaky, but it was a very easy thing for me to do, to kind of slip outside of myself and into another point of view. You know, the way that sometimes we can tell the truth more purely when we wear masks.
And we were talking about that with acting earlier, you know, how much of that is an escape and how much of it is an exploration, to be able to have the license to explore humanity in that way, to become somebody else and look around.
I felt a kind of permission, too, in Hadley's point of view to explore all kinds of things more emotionally and immediately than I would have if I had been writing from my own point of view. For instance, when I was writing The Paris Wife, which is about the rise and fall of a marriage, I was going through the demise of my own marriage. Now, I could not, if you had held a gun to my head, I could not have written about my own marriage from my own point of view, but somehow writing Hadley's story allowed a lot of the feeling of the end of a marriage and what that means to come out.
Did that have anything to do, I mean, was that happening concurrently, or had one begun before the other?
It was happening concurrently, yeah.
That's interesting.
Yeah, it is interesting. I'm sure my therapist would have a lot to say about it.
Your therapist is writing your memoir.
Maybe.
At first I was a little concerned about your research because, you know, I live 15 minutes north of Paris, Michigan. And I was like, this place in the 20s could not have been this awesome. They have a miniature tower there by the fish hatchery, and they have a little pizzeria, and they have a gravel pit. And I just couldn't work out the geometry. I'm like, you know, and Hemingway was where?
It's very much the same. It's very much the same, yeah.
And how many of you have been to the Osceola Inn? Back when it was still firing up. No? I mean, because, you know, Hemingway and probably Jim Harrison probably had a drink there at some point. So.
I used to tend bar there. That's why he's bringing
Reed
it
City,
up.
Reed City, Michigan.
In Reed City, Michigan.
Bam.
Absolutely. Woohoo! Woohoo!
First book published out of Kalamazoo. You know? Are we seeing all these parallels to Michigan? Being so deep in all of that research, how did you manage it? I mean, there must have just been voluminous piles. And another question onto that is, you know, you found Hadley through letters, through love letters. Is there a feeling now, I mean, you're raising a young, you know, two young children, I am too, are they writing letters anymore? There's this idea that it's a disappearing object in the world. I used to love a letter because, you know, it had a stamp with an image and a time that it left a place. It was signed by someone personally. It came to me. It told me exactly where it was coming. It was a great object for history. And I maybe get two or three letters a year now, and they're all from writers, or occasionally a reader. And I think about these things, like now we're researching these literary people of the past, and we really are tracing them through their letters, whether they like it or not. What do you think about that now as someone who might one day be looking at all of us? What are they going to find other than our memoirs, which explain it all, except for the things we didn't tell you?
No, I think it's a shame that we don't write letters, because of course it is a physical record. It's a breadcrumb trail for someone else to follow, your grandkids, etc. But mostly I think it's a way to record our own thoughts. You know, Virginia Woolf used to sit down every single day and have her correspondence, like hours a day.
Yeah.
It's a one way we understand her life, and thank goodness we have this resource. But it's also a way that she was making sense of her own life and what was happening to her. And I'm not sure that we have that, anything that sort of fills that particular role now, because we do this, and it's sound bites and snapshots and, you know, ADHD.
And people really labored over those sentences in those letters. They're beautiful.
They're beautiful.
And they're corrected sometimes. You can see that sometimes they had to go back over it. I think that's kind of interesting that they wanted it just right, you know, these little transmissions from where they were.
Hemingway had crazy handwriting. and when I began to read his letters, I could not, I had no idea. And over time, I got to know him in that way. And it's a pretty intimate thing, reading somebody's letters, sort of like a fly on the wall or looking over his shoulder. And it's a way to sort of reach through time and space. It's pretty miraculous, actually. Go write letters, is what we're saying.
Yeah, go write letters.
Go home and write a letter.
Write me a letter.
Write Van a letter.
I think it's interesting with both letters and how you began to move into her through her own voice, kind of taking that on yourself, a whole book. How do you leave that voice, or does it still sneak up on you? Does she still speak to you?
Ooh.
There's things she hasn't said, I'm sure, in the book, which were left unresolved between the two of you.
It was really difficult to let that book go and to let those people go, because I felt very, very attached to them. And I mean, in a way, all the veils, you know, kind of collapsed. And in the end, I wrote the book really fast. It took me 5 years to write my first novel and 7 months to write The Paris Wife.
And it's interesting. And
like in a fever.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I had quit I had sort of three different teaching jobs. I was sort of, you know, piecing together a career that way, you know, not a very good living. Quit all my teaching jobs to write in a Starbucks near my house in Cleveland. And I was very proletariat about it, you know, sort of 9 to 3 every single day, like writing my face off, because I wanted the book more than I had ever wanted anything, but also because I was being completely swept away. Like all of it, learning about a time period I had never sort of really experienced from the inside out, like very dramatically and intimately through this particular scrim. I felt like I really got to know this woman and got to know this marriage from the inside out, and that dirty rat, Ernest Hemingway, I was madly in love with him. I was dreaming about him. I mean, I was hearing his voice and her voice, and I was so in it, you know, I was so in that relationship that even though I had done all the research, I saw all the way down the line and back, the man gets married 4 times, like he cannot possibly keep Hadley, and yet I found myself hoping against hope that somehow these two kids would work it out.
What's interesting about that, of course, is you're writing in a coffee shop about a bunch of people who hang out in coffee shops for an entire book.
Yeah, and a Starbucks in Cleveland is a lot like a Parisian cafe. A lot. Speaking of Paris, there's a T-shirt that says Cleveland is my Paris. And I just want to say for the record that Cleveland is not my Paris. Can I just say?
And you finally went to Paris, but only after your book was done.
Right.
I mean, it's obviously a different city, but many of the same buildings. It's preserved much of its history throughout that time period.
Yes.
How did that feel to kind of walk the same streets?
Right. Well, so I do a lot of events, and people always say, oh my God, you know, Paris came alive. You must have lived there. You know, you must know Paris really well. And in one way, I feel like a terrible fraud because I wrote the book without having ever been to Paris. But I could not. Yes, you are breathing, sort of like Darth Vader,
a little bit. I'm a little breathy.
I could not have afforded to go to Paris. If I had sold plasma every single day, I could not have afforded to go to Paris. I was dead broke writing that book. And so I had to make it up. I invented it. I read everything I could about Paris in the 20s. I read all of Hemingway, and then I would have to read, you know, F. Scott Fitzgerald and Gertrude Stein and Ezra Pound, and all of these people came alive to me, and the world came alive to me. And I actually think there's something about, like, an urgency that was created and a kind of intensity because I couldn't go there and was dying to go there. And so it worked beautifully. The book, I think, came out more quickly and with a kind of fever, you know? So that when I began to work on the Africa book, for instance.
Where you can really get fever.
Where you can really get malaria, for instance.
Yeah.
There's tsetse fly. I decided to be superstitious and that I wasn't going to let myself go to Africa until after I finished the book.
Did, with the Africa book, how did you find Beryl Markham? I mean, we found Hadley through a movable feast, but how did she speak to you?
So like Hadley, who was she really is sort of the great surprise of my life, and I feel sometimes that she just kind of knocked me over like a crosstown bus. You know, I never went looking for that. I never went looking for her. I never thought I would write a historical novel. But then once I had written that book and it was such a success, and that had never happened to me before. I mean, I'd been writing for 15 years and I couldn't give my books away. And then suddenly it seemed like I had tapped into something that was really working on multiple levels because it was working for me too. You know, I didn't set out to write a bestseller. I don't think you can, actually. But then the follow-up, thinking about what would come next, was incredibly difficult for me, not just to satisfy expectations. Suddenly I had 1.6 million readers when I hadn't had like three before. So there's a difference. That's a difference. Or my editor or my publisher, like having crazy town expectations about a follow-up, and, you know, could I write The Paris Wife 2? Paris Wife Redux, what about the Key West wife, you know? So aside from everybody else's expectations and the voices in my head that had never been there before, it was mostly me I was worried about because I had fallen so madly in love with Hadley and she had electrified my imagination. How was I ever gonna find somebody? And because it was an intimate relationship, and then, just a few years ago, I went on vacation with my sisters and my brother-in-law to Florida. My brother-in-law is a doctor, but he's also a pilot, and that weekend he was reading Beryl Markham's A Movable Feast. And I had never read it.
Into the West.
Oh, excuse me? Oh, thank you.
West into the Night.
Have you guys read it? Do you? West with the Night.
Thank you.
Yeah. Woo! West with the Night, which I had never heard of, and I'd never heard of Beryl Markham before, and he kept sort of looking up from the side of the pool saying, oh my God, this woman is amazing. She's completely incredible. You need to know about her, and in fact, I think you're going to write about her. Well, he's my brother-in-law, so I ignored him, totally, because I always ignore him just as a... and I took the book home and I buried it on my bookshelf and for a year and a half struggled with what my next idea would be. And then one day, at the edge of reason, I just picked up the book and I opened it and read one paragraph from Beryl's African childhood and all the hairs on the back of my neck stood up. And I didn't even know who she was yet, but I knew I was going to write about her. And I didn't know all sorts of things about her. I didn't know that she had met Ernest Hemingway on safari in 1934.
It was a small club down there.
It was a small club down there. Yeah. And in fact, he blurbed her book. Like, I didn't know that. Because she was an accident. Because she was a fluke. And yet, in other ways, it does seem like I was destined, that I'm destined to write about her.
You like outsiders. You know, Hadley was an outsider to the artist community in Paris, even though she was married to it. Beryl was a child in a hut in Africa, and then became kind of a solo pilot. She did this alone. What is it about the solitary woman who's kind of fierce and
is this like a Barbara Walters thing? Are you trying to like psychologize me?
Why haven't you cried yet, Paula? Cry for me.
Get to the bottom of my psyche. I do like strong women, and I like underdogs, I think. I mean, I identify that way. Seems a funny thing to say, right? I identify as an underdog, but I kind of do identify as an underdog and think that if I have anything, I mean, the reason I'm a writer is because I have tenacity more than talent, because I didn't give up. And I like women who stick to their guns. They are true to themselves. They are unapologetically themselves. Obviously, Hadley is a much quieter version of that than Beryl, who is just, she's just a kind of a bad. And I felt in writing that book that I had somehow gotten wrapped up in like a Thelma and Louise movie, you know, riding shotgun with Beryl Markham. It's pretty awesome.
Yeah, I just kind of felt that with, you know, as a foster child, you're kind of still, you're in the house, you're in the family, but you're the outsider. And you kind of chose these characters, which had a certain thematic similarity to the way you'd lived your life, which I thought was interesting. Mm. Did, as you researched Beryl, obviously that would be even harder because there weren't nearly as many letters. And her own memoir is sparse about her interior self.
Deliberately sparse.
Yeah.
Yes.
How did you then kind of create that space?
So if you've read West with the Night, have we read West with the Night?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, so it was first published in 1942. What's that?
It's a very literary audience.
Yeah, it's a great audience, actually. First published in 1942 and mostly sort of goes over in a beautiful way and in a highly stylized way her adventures. You know, sort of she's the first woman to fly the Atlantic solo and nonstop in 1936. She was a bush pilot. She was the first licensed female racehorse trainer in the world when she was 18 years old. I mean, over and over again, she tackled all kinds of things that women of her era simply didn't do. So there's that. But what's obviously missing is the personal. And it just sort of begged the question. And it's the same experience that I felt reading A Movable Feast, in fact, the exact same experience. So if you read A Movable Feast, you read all these, there's tenderness and poignancy and regret, there's a feeling, but what's missing is the stories. Like, we don't really know how Ernest and Hadley's marriage falls apart, and Ernest doesn't turn the spotlight on himself, he turns it outward on his friends, and he tells terrible stories and pisses people off and loses friends because of that book. I wanted to get to the bottom of the real story at the heart of A Movable Feast. And the same thing happened when I was reading West with the Night, which is, where's Beryl in this? Like, how did she become herself? How did she become that singular, fearless woman? And so I became obsessed and started reading biographies. So I had her voice from her memoir, but I didn't have her thing, you know, her essence. And it was a great surprise when I started reading biography. All kinds of things were a surprise to me. Yummy stuff like, oh my goodness, this woman was involved for 10 years in a juicy love triangle with Karen Blixen, who wrote Out of Africa under the pen name Isak Dinson, and Denys Finch Hatton, who in my private life I call Robert Redford, right? Right? Aren't we just sick for that movie? Is that movie? I mean, I have whole chunks of that movie memorized, and have often had the dream where Robert Redford washes my hair. And I used to teach out of Africa, and I just thought, hold the phones. Beryl Markham is not in Out of Africa, and she's not. And Karen Blixen is not in Beryl's book either. So there was like that kind of yummy awareness, or like the Hemingway connection. But there's also the discovery that Beryl and I were exactly the same age when our mother abandoned us. And exactly the same age when our mothers came back.
I'm onto something.
Right?
Yeah.
Like, you cannot make that stuff up. So when I said earlier, it's a fluke that I found Beryl as a subject, but also seems like destiny, I mean, that's why.
Why won't you cry for me, Paula?
It's just not going to happen, my friend.
Isn't a movable feast, isn't that Hemingway's great line, all you have to do is write one true sentence, write the truest sentence, you know?
One true sentence about everything you know in your gut, yeah.
Yeah. There's some steamy scenes in Circling the Sun.
Which we saw when you were wearing the...
Was that well-researched as well?
Now what are you getting at? I've actually had readers tell me that I don't write enough sex into my books. I don't know. I should put it in a newsletter or something.
And obviously they've both been optioned for films. Did you see them since Out of Africa and the movie itself? You love both, yeah?
Yeah.
So do you now kind of fantasize these books, since you've seen them in your own way in creating them, do you kind of worry that they're going to blow it?
They're going to get it wrong?
You've already made the best movie of it.
In my mind, right? Which is where everything happens. You know, it was interesting when The Paris Wife came out, so this was February of 2011, just a few months later, Woody Allen's movie, Midnight in Paris, came out, which was just an uncanny coincidence. It sort of like, it felt like sort of hooking into the cultural zeitgeist in some way. So I was actually still on the road touring for The Paris Wife, and people would say, have you seen this movie? And I'm like, I live in Cleveland. Like, I don't know what you're talking about. But then when I did, I was flabbergasted that we were having the same, in a way, thoughts and obsessions with a certain time period and a cast of characters. So in a way, Woody Allen ruined some stuff for me. We need to call him up right now, or write him letters. We could write.
You'll make him very agitated, nervous.
Letters, because in a way, like when The Paris Wife was optioned, immediately then people were like, "Oh, but the movie was already made, right? Didn't Woody Allen already make that movie?"
Did you warm up your slapping hand?
I still can.
When you and obviously Beryl was British, this was imperial land, which I like to call my plot down in Reed City, because it just sounds so much better, doesn't it? Wouldn't you rather have imperial land than a yard? You know. And you must have found some interesting turns of phrases, like, you know, has your gizzard gone to the Queen's latrine, sir? You know, did you find anything really rich in the language of the time that you kind of still sticks with you and you wish you could use it, but it's fallen so far out of use?
It was very tricky kind of getting her Britishness right. Like, how British was she? And there's a U.S. version of the book, but then there's also a U.K. version of the book. And in the U.S. version of the book, there was a British copy editor to kind of help with small things like we say boot instead of trunk, or we say champ, a horse champs instead of chomps, or we say, you know, it's American to say yard or what have you. So, and that was fine with the Americans. She was British enough with the UK copy editor. But then in the UK, they're like, oh my God, Beryl is so American. And then she had to go through, seriously, poor Beryl, like 17 other layers of copy editing to get all the Americanisms out. And that's just that wasn't Beryl's fault. That was my fault in sort of doing Beryl and in contriving her voice and her consciousness.
We don't call it a yard, we call it Imperial Land.
We call it Imperial Land.
Well, I want to have my book translated into English now, too.
It's very funny. It's very funny.
You've written other books which have been pulled back after much attention. How hard is that to follow another story, another novel, another book project, and walk away somehow? You know, we talked a little bit about one that you were working on that you've stopped.
You mean that I failed?
We're all failing. It's just in measure.
I read something recently that I quite like. Never underestimate failure as a source of inspiration.
It's worked for me.
I love that. So the failed book was actually between The Paris Wife and Circling the Sun. I wrote a whole other book in that time about Marie Curie. And in fact, I think when I was here in 2012, I might have talked about that. I mean, I was under contract to write that novel. Again, from her point of view, you know, I got to go back to Paris, I thought, you know. It's 1894, there's no sex, but there's radium, you know.
They're both spicy.
They're both. And I thought I should be able to write that book. Pierre dies tragically, tick, you know, like, that's good, that works, and I find her life so inspiring. And what I think now is that there's nothing rational about why a book works or doesn't work. I mean, if I was a good actress, if I was simply a mimic, I would be able to climb into the consciousness of Marie Curie and tell her story. But I think I have to be, in a strange way, completely abducted, like abducted by a character.
Really?
Really. That a character kind of has to latch onto my imagination. And again, I think it's mysterious to me, whatever the connection is, but it's there. It's obvious to me. It's like being struck by lightning. It's not at all subtle what happens when a character really takes hold in my imagination.
Have you seen Misery? And does that make you nervous? We want the Paris Wife too, seriously. I guess not. Sorry. We'll give you a pass. Have you ever had you wake up from a fugue state and you've written a chapter and you can't figure out where it came from or even what it belongs to? Have you written pieces of other make-believe completely, not based on character or fiction? Like, this is an isolated incident of creativity that just came to me. And I don't even know if I'll ever finish it, but it kind of sits there in a pile somewhere.
I haven't really had that experience, but one of my favorite experiences is lost time. Being in this, you know, when I wrote in the same Starbucks every day near my house in Cleveland. I sat in the same chair every day. They played the same Nora Jones CD every day. I had the same tall dark roast coffee, which cost me $1.85 every single day. And some days I would look up and 4 hours had disappeared. And I was going to be late to get the bus for my kid, you know? That's the best day. That's the best day when it just feels like I climbed into a time machine today. That's what happened. And some days it doesn't feel like that at all, but you do the work anyway.
Why couldn't you write at home?
Because my kids were there. No, my kids were really little when I was working on The Paris Wife. And I know mothers who can work at home, out of the home, and close the door and find a way to get into that space that they need. Can you do it? Can you work at home?
It's all I've got. We don't have a Starbucks in Reed City. and they knocked down the Osceola Inn.
But you have like the Moose Lodge.
I could go hang out in the yogurt factory.
You know? The yogurt factory.
Nice little section in the Way area. But do you need that kind of separation now that you've kind of established this habit? It's a ritual.
Well, now there's this beautiful separation. It's called public school. I love my children. But they go to school every day. And so from 9 o'clock until 3 o'clock, that's my work day. And I am very proletariat about it. You know, I think I have girlfriends who believe that pretty much I sit around eating bonbons, you know, and dashing off a few words and say, done, shoe shopping now. or that look at me and they're like, okay, so you write, but what do you do? And not understand how it could take me all day, you know, 8 hours to write 1,000 words.
Yeah. Do your children begin to speak into these stories as you watch your children grow older? You get different voices, get different sensibilities, maybe forgetting your own at that age when you were...
My kids show up in my books?
Well, do they inform characters who are of that age? Are they beginning to speak this through your life? Your surroundings begin to inform whatever it is you're creating as a surrounding.
No, I think I keep my that part of my life quite separate from my art. But you were saying today that you saw yourself in your father's
work. Yeah, I grew up in his books.
Yeah, you grew up in his books, and you saw yourself growing up that way. I think that would be fascinating. I think my kids would like to see themselves in my books. And sometimes they get very excited about seeing the Paris wife, for instance, in the world, you know. Or sometimes they humble me. We were in Target once, and the Paris wife had just been named one of the top 10 books of the year by People magazine. Oh my gosh, I was excited. I was jumping up and down in the Target, you know, like, there's mommy. And my daughter looks at me and she's like, are you ever gonna write another book?
And you got the first one right.
From the mouths of babes.
Speaking of another book, can we speak of another book?
I don't know, can we?
These are questions I don't have the answers to.
Nor do I.
I write them down and there's just a blank afterwards.
Am I writing another book?
Yeah.
God, I hope so.
Is it historical fiction?
Yeah, I mean, I'm pretty addicted to the genre now. It's an absolutely amazing thing to me that writing about people who actually lived, you can go into the world where they actually lived and meet people who knew them, right?
Right.
Right. I mean, so I do events all the time where people will come up to me and they'll say something like, you know, I knew Hemingway, you know, or I worked in the hospital in St. Mary's when he was getting shock treatment therapy, or I met the guy who owned the sandwich shop across the street from where Hemingway used to go and get treatment, or someone who owned the apartment building where he and Hadley lived on North Dearborn Street after they were first married. You know, like these little connections that feel, they build a fabric of something pretty profound, right? And so when I went over to Africa, it was astonishing to me that there would be people, because I didn't go over there to do research, right? I went over there to go to church, to just like be in the physical space where my characters were, and just, I don't know, to sort of give thanks for the experience and the ride and kind of honor their experience and the experience that I had been having with them. So I go over, and lo and behold, like Beryl's jockey of 20 years is still alive and kicking. Oh. And working at the race course, 80-something years old, this guy named Buster Parnell, you know, sat there and had a conversation with me, or a woman named Patty Migdal, who was another racehorse trainer in Nairobi, a contemporary of Beryl's, who's 92 years old, invited me to tea when she found out what I had done. I'm wearing this smashing yellow pantsuit. It's beautiful. I mean, really, that these people lived and that she lived, to me is kind of I don't know, it's a privilege for me.
And her life story was actually quite fascinating because of the reissue of her book in America. Mm. You know, she was not doing well back in Africa at the time of that.
No, she was destitute, living in a borrowed house on the racetrack, quite ill with her dogs when West with the Night was reprinted, and the reason West with the Night was reprinted in the 80s was because of Ernest Hemingway.
Right. Circles.
It all comes back around.
And the Nick Adams stories are about right here and a little bit north, so Hemingway was all over us. Talk a little bit about her. I mean, her childhood was what gripped you when she spoke about her childhood, and then going into that world. Kind of amazing. I mean, you know, leopards would come into her bedroom and drag her dog off. I mean, who raises their
well,
children
she was
like
attacked
that?
By a, she was attacked by a lion when she was 10 years old. Like, a lot of physical drama, and the world was so raw and untamed. And I've always been fascinated by deprivation stories. We talked about this today, right? Little House, right? I just wanted to be on the edge of, like, a big storm, you know, with, like, one stick of wood. and Ma had to make biscuits out of dirt, you know? That was a story that I connected with, right? So the fact that Beryl grew up this kind of fierce, wild creature at the edge of, what, the forest with leopards and puff adders, and that she would, after her mother abandoned her, kind of push back against that loss and trauma by reinventing herself as a young warrior in training. Like, girls didn't do that in her class or any other, right? Didn't hunt, didn't tackle these worlds, didn't take on so much. So I was fascinated by kind of her psyche and how she builds her psyche as a kind of pushback, how she develops a particular species of courage. Like, that was interesting to me. But I was also became more and more interested in, why don't we know Beryl Markham?
Yeah.
Right? So she was a contemporary of Amelia Earhart. She did these extraordinary things. And yet, if you read her Wikipedia page, all of her accomplishments, which are
pretty lengthy,
kind of become a side note to her personal life and the gossip and speculation and scandal that surrounded her for her entire life. All kinds of things. We're more interested in what famous people she may or may not have slept with than what she actually accomplished. And so writing the book somehow became, quite by accident, a feminist act, right? To put her back into her rightful place in history and to give her story another look, which it definitely deserves, and to answer all kinds of questions, like, you know, it's been a rumor for 20, 30 years that Beryl didn't even write West with the Night. You guys heard that rumor? Yeah, it's on the Wikipedia page, too.
That makes it true.
That makes it true. You know that, right? So the thing is, Beryl was married three times, and when she was married to her third husband, she was working on West with the Night, and she thanks him in her acknowledgments. His name was Raoul Schumacher. He was, biographers call him a Hollywood ghostwriter, but no one's been able to find anything he actually wrote. But he did, at a party once, when he and Beryl were on the skids, tell a friend that Beryl didn't write one word of that book. And so we believe him because he simply said it. Beryl's biographer, Mary Lovell, who wrote a wonderful book called Straight On Till Morning, sort of has found physical evidence that Beryl, in fact, delivered two-thirds of the book to her publisher before she ever met Raoul Schumacher.
Were the drafts ever found? I mean, did you actually get to see?
Yes, exactly. The physical, and letters back and forth to editors. Oh. But we like gossip. We like gossip, and I think we're far more willing to believe gossip than we should be.
And do you worry now that, I mean, are you attracted to historical fiction because of the fact that it takes place in such scarcity, such barrens, such hardship? And do we have that anymore? I mean, obviously there's hardship in the world, but do we just go move there with our kids anymore? You know, like, hey, you know what? I'm going to build a hut. And you're all coming with me.
But you know, the thing that Paris Wife and Circling the Sun have in common, too, is like this really interesting bohemian community. You know, there are expats living in the Rift Valley, too, and kind of burning it down the same way the expats were in Paris in the 20s. So clearly I'm drawn to a good party as well as deprivation.
Yeah. I would love for you to read from the beginning of your book, if you would be so kind.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. I might need some lights. So I'm just going to be reading from the beginning of the book, so you don't need to know anything at all. This is just Beryl talking about her childhood. Before Kenya was Kenya, when it was millions of years old and yet still somehow new, the name belonged only to our most magnificent mountain. You could see it from our farm in Njoro, in the British East African protectorate, hard-edged at the far end of a stretching golden plain, its crown glazed with ice that never completely melted. Behind us, the Mau forest was blue with strings of mist. Before us, the Rongai Valley sloped down and away, bordered on one side by the strange, high Menengai crater, which the natives called the Mountain of God, and on the other by the distant Aberdare Range, rounded blue-gray hills that went smoky and purple at dusk before dissolving into the night sky. When we first arrived in 1904, the farm wasn't anything but 1,500 acres of untouched bush and three weather-beaten huts. This, my mother said, the air around her humming and shimmering as if it were alive. You sold everything for this? Other farmers are making a go of it in tougher places, Clara, my father said. You're not a farmer, Charles, she spat before bursting into tears. He was a horseman, in fact. What he knew was steeplechasing and fox hunting and the tame lanes and hedgerows of Rutland. But he had seen paper flyers hawking cheap imperial land, and an idea had latched on to him that wouldn't let go. We left Westfield House, where I was born, and traveled 7,000 miles past Tunis and Tripoli and Suez, the waves like great gray mountains swallowing the sky, and then through Kilindini Harbor and the port of Mombasa, which smelled of sharp spices and drying fish, and then on to the snaking train bound for Nairobi, the windows boiling over with red dust. I stared at everything, completely thrilled in a way I hadn't remembered feeling before, because whatever this place was, it was like nothing and nowhere else. We settled in and worked to make our situation livable, pushing against the wildness, while the wildness pushed back with everything it had. Our land had no visible borders or fences, and our huts lacked proper doors. Silky banded colobus monkeys climbed through the burlap sacking covering our windows. Plumbing was unheard of. When nature called, you walked out into the night with all the things that wanted to have at you and hung your derriere over a long drop, whistling to keep your fear away. We'll leave it at deprivation, how about? Should I stay for Q&A? Can you come up?
I'm not going to lie. If monkeys crawled through my walls in Reed City, I would have two emotions. One would be absolute joy, and the other would be concern.
You know. Yeah, concern. But I love that. Monkeys, burlap sacking. I mean, right, long drops and...
You don't see people making those decisions now. You know, I'm going to give up everything for burlap sack house.
But there's
I mean, it's not much different than mine, but it's, you know, we have insulation.
But there is the romance, and that is the frontier experience, right? And the pioneering experience, which is to make something out of nothing, and that calls to a certain kind of person. The challenge of that, you know, can bring you more alive.
And there's some of that person in you, isn't there?
Maybe. Maybe.
We'll wait till you have a little more imperial land for sale. I'd love to open it up for questions. I know there's so many people who have read and loved her book, so please.
Hello.
We have someone in the back and every
Y'all
side
look
and everywhere.
Awesome, by the way. Thanks for coming out.
And we're going to take a group portrait a little bit later with
Paula. We'll have a mic on the floor here, so just stand and say your name, and Ben will point to you as we go. Who's first?
I shall point to you.
We have a question in the balcony.
There.
Hi, Paula.
Hi, Anne.
I have to say, this is the first time I've asked a question, but
I thought you were a plant.
No. I was intrigued by the dad, Burkle's father, and he was so disappointing. You know, he never wrote. He just seemed so distant. They really didn't have very good conversations. But she just continued to adore him and never lost faith and never said, my stupid dad, he never talks to me, you know? I mean, he just sort of left her to marry some horrible man. But she never held it against him. So I just thought that was kind of interesting.
Yeah, I mean, I think if I'm going to psychologize her, which obviously is what I do as a writer, right? I psychologize my characters. Oh, pardon? Did we hear that? Did you guys hear the question? Yeah? Okay. The family romance, right, of being in adoring your father or being sort of in love with your father, romanticizing his role in your life when he is still disappointed you, I think it's a pretty common story. But what Beryl thought, how she saw her own beginnings, is that the neglect and having to make her own way, right, actually was the making of her. That was the building of her character, that she was left to her own devices. And I believe that's true too. So in one way, we can give him a bye, right? Because he contributed to this pretty remarkable woman.
And then there's that Hemingway. We're not doing well in historical fiction, guys. Way up on top.
Yeah, I thought it was interesting.
Right there.
That, somebody upstairs?
I'm sorry, yeah, right up on top there.
And speaking about that bastard Hemingway, in The Paris Wife, when Hadley forgets all of his manuscripts on the train, could that have perhaps been a supreme act of passive aggression?
Did we all hear that question? When Hadley loses Hemingway's manuscripts on the train, usually what people want to know is, did that actually happen? Which, of course, it did. But the question from above was, do I think that that was perhaps an act of passive aggression? Was Hadley trying to sabotage his career? It was suggested by a Canadian reviewer, in fact, that I had dropped the ball with the book, that I could have made Hadley a much more interesting character if I had made her passive-aggressive, that I had made her a saboteur of Hemingway's career, that she deliberately did that because he had left her on her own for so much, and sort of, you know, they were living in poverty, and he was privileging his work, et cetera, et cetera. I don't personally believe that on any conscious level Hadley was trying to sabotage his career, and in fact, it made her ill for the rest of her life when she thought about that moment. It made him ill, and I believe, in fact, that it was the beginning of the end of their marriage, because he couldn't, not only could he not sort of trust her, because he had really unreasonable expectations for loyalty and perfection from the people around him, but it was more that if she could have left his work on the train and his work was him, did she really get him? Did she really get him all the way down? Did she understand what he was about? That maybe there was that gap.
Right down here.
Hello.
Oh, okay. I went back and read West with the Night after reading Circling the Sun. I'd read it probably 25 years ago. And I was really fascinated that she only gives Finch Hatton maybe 2.5 pages in West with the Night, and it's all about his desire or his interest in scouting for the elephant hunters, the big game hunters, which she later on picked up and made a career for herself. And Finch Hatton himself apparently never wrote much of anything. And I'm just wondering how you pieced all that together. Of course, West with the Night also had nothing about any of her marriages that
right.
I remember. Yeah.
Yeah. So the way I pieced together a lot of Beryl's life was by reading biography, But then that also left holes. You know, some of the stuff that I knew about Beryl, I know because Karen Blixen wrote her mother every Sunday for decades. For decades. And not just like, how are you? The weather's nice here.
Yeah.
You know, she really dug in and described her community and all the people, the texture of the community, the texture of life there, and wrote a lot about Beryl. Wrote a lot about Beryl's comings and goings, when she and her husband were on the outs, when Beryl was staying at the house because nobody knew what to make of her. She wrote about feeling worried for her. I mean, all kinds of things. That's why I know the relationship actually was an intimate one and exists, whether either woman was prepared to write about it. You know, it was almost, it seems to me, to be a very loud silence that neither woman writes about the other, and a loud silence that Beryl doesn't seem to know how to tackle her attachment to Finch Hatton, but understand that she was the other woman. Like, for 10 years, she pursued him when he was in love with her friend. Like, maybe she wasn't willing to kind of confess that.
Well, apparently he was quite a fascinating character.
He was. He looked nothing like Robert Redford. He was like 6'3" and almost entirely bald, and loved poetry and music and art. But he also was a physical specimen. Like, he could rip a deck of cards in half with his hands as a party trick. He could shoot anything. He could sort of recite poetry while he could shoot anything. And apparently had so much natural charisma and magnetism that any woman that passed within a 10-foot radius literally fell over. Fell over. So it didn't matter if he looked like Robert Redford. He had him coming and going.
Right here?
The bar has been raised.
How do you get access to these personal letters that have proved to be such a valuable source, and where do you usually find them? In libraries, museums, or personal sources?
Mm. Well, Karen Blixen's letters have been published. I mean, she's such a well-known figure, and her work is so important to us. Hadley's letters, Hadley and Hemingway's letters, I found in a library, in the John F. Kennedy Memorial Library in Boston. And in order to access them, I had to ask for permission and to prove that I was a serious scholar, by which I mean to say I lied. I mean, what was I going to say? Like, I'm a novelist, and I think I might be writing a book about these people. It was really very interesting, that whole experience about going into the archives, you know, and going to the library. And so all of Hemingway's papers are there.
Can you touch them, or do you have to use special?
They're in the vault. Like, you have to like apply to touch the mimeographs, you know. Like, anyway, all of his letters, everything in manuscript form. It's like the Church of Hemingway. Some of his personal effects, furniture from his house. I mean, it's extraordinary. It's an extraordinary experience. And when I was there, it was January, and almost nobody was there. But I kept seeing the same woman every day. And we kept kind of eyeing each other in the little room as we were like furiously writing things on note cards. And around about the third day, she looks at me and she's like, okay, so who are you? Who are you and what are you working on? And I said, well, actually, I'm just a novelist. And I'm writing a novel from the point of view of Hadley Hemingway. And she looks at me and she's like, really? Well, I interviewed her for my book on Zelda. And it was Nancy Milford. Right, who thought she might be writing a book about Rose Kennedy, but she couldn't find any dirt. Imagine not being able to find any dirt on Rose Kennedy. That was my experience.
Some hands, right here.
So what did you tell your brother-in-law?
All right. What did I tell my brother-in-law? He's still waiting for his royalty check. Oh my goodness, he stinking loves the fact that I owe him now. He loves it. He's like, I'll take cash or a vintage biplane. No, he loves it.
He would want royalties.
He would.
Warren.
Exactly.
Back corner.
I have a question about Circling the Sun. I just finished it a few days ago, and I kept waiting for something good to happen to Beryl.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, I felt a little disappointed at the end. I felt like maybe you left off more good parts when things started to go better for her, and I wondered if there was a reason why you did that.
Yes. So the book ends, and in fact, the first time I ended the book, I cut off even more good stuff. Because it may be Machiavellian or something. The first time I ended the book, I actually ended with Finch Hatton's plane crash. You guys know that happens, right? No spoilers. You know, it's pretty well known. It's in the movie.
He's Darth Vader?
that he dies this way. And then the more I thought about it, the more I thought, actually, one of the things that Finch Hatton's death does is it frees Beryl to fly. You know, he inspired her to fly, but I also think that his death encouraged her in kind of a tricky way. So Beryl, one of the ways that I understand her psyche is that like Hemingway, or like a Hemingway character, she actually needed to confront the things that most terrified her. She needed to tackle them head on so that they didn't sneak up on her. So she wasn't fearless. I use that word a lot when I talk about Beryl, but in fact, there's no such thing as a fearless person. It's what we do in the face of fear that defines our character. And so Beryl needed to push back against the things that she was terrified of. Her lover falls out of the sky, and so she solos within 1 month of his death and takes it on like in a fever, like a crazy person. And what I wanted to show was something which I think is actually quite positive. So she believed for 10 years that Denys, if she could just have him, he would solve something for her, right? He would put order into the chaos of her life, when in fact, she orders her own life. And she somehow, after all the things that have happened to her, believes that she has the power to soar, you know, believes that she has the power to tackle the sky, and in fact is, the way I see the ending, is the one she's been waiting for, you know, which is a pretty positive message, I think, for women.
I'm Chris Seeley. My question is, would you give the explanation and all the psychology of the title? I just wondered, you know, I was trying to figure out, does it have to do with the fact that she, you know, flew from continent to continent? Part of that was Denys, the sun she was circling. And I mean that S-U-N, you know. But, you know, I just would be interested in your reason.
You have thought about this.
Yeah.
I love that. It's like a book club. Don't we feel like we're in a book club right now?
Yeah.
Isn't that awesome? Yay, book clubs. Woohoo! I think that's why we have book clubs, by the way, just as a little aside, so that we can chew this stuff over. Well, what do you think? What do you think the title means? I think the most, I mean, certainly Denys is the sun. The way that these two remarkable, unforgettable women who were so independent in some ways kind of both lose their heads and can't stop from pursuing him, even though he wasn't for the having, right? So there's that bit of it. But there's also the Icarus myth, right? We know what happens to Icarus, right? When he flies too close to the sun, the wax on his wings melts and he falls to earth, which is what happens to Finch Hatton. But also the kind of intensity of experience, of living on the edge of experience and taking great risks, comes with great costs. And to me, that is the definition of Beryl's arc. You know, as a woman, she had great freedom, and it came at an incredible cost. She took on these incredible adventures, and in the end, you know, died in poverty in Nairobi. You know?
It's also interesting that she flew at night on the opposite side of the sun, you know, 2,000 feet over the water,
yeah.
Which is...
Yeah, I like the way those two titles talk to each other too, Circling the Sun and West with the Night. They seem to be And the way I understand my book is that it's in conversation with Beryl's book. And I understand The Paris Wife that way, too, as being in conversation with A Movable Feast, not in competition with, but sort of doing a dance with, kind of filling in the gaps and illuminating bits of shadowy history and experience, calling forth minor characters that were, in fact, major characters.
And I was thinking just time. You know, a year is a circle around a sun once. So, because it's historical and because, you know, we gather ourselves as we go along.
So deep.
Look what you've done. Just talk about the title for the rest of the night. Right here. Oh, you have one right there?
Hi, Paula. I'm Susan. Welcome back.
Hi, Susan.
I have a two-part question. The first is to update us on Beryl's son, and the other is you mentioned the word feminism, and I'm wondering if you can say something about women's stories being told in a historical fiction way as a way to sell.
Yeah. So Beryl's son, Jarvis, have we read the book? I don't want to say too much. Okay. She didn't raise her son. He was, in fact, raised by his paternal grandmother. Interestingly, he and Beryl managed to have a positive relationship. In fact, he remembered her very well and was incredibly proud of her, even though she was a distant figure in his life. He died in a terrible automobile accident when he was in his 40s in the 1970s. Terrible. I mean, it was a shame. About feminism, I do think that there's something that I find pretty now. Again, it was an accident. I could not possibly have like carved out this arc for myself as a career path. But I find it very satisfying to take these women who have been eclipsed a little bit by history. If you think about, you know, Hemingway, he's such a huge figure. He like totally overshadowed Hadley. Nobody knew who she was, and if they did, well, she was just the Paris wife, right? She was the early wife. She was the one, you know, who lost those manuscripts on the train, the dits, you know. He wrote her out of The Sun Also Rises, you know. Incredibly autobiographical writer. Every person that was in his personal life in that moment in time is a character in that novel, except for Hadley. And yet she was there for all of it. And so that felt like a feminist act for me to put her back into her rightful place and also to kind of turn it on its head a little bit. There she is at the side of the bullring, like feather stitching baby clothes, right? That was interesting to me. And so Beryl, for whatever reason, maybe because she was a notorious woman and looked like Greta Garbo and kind of took no prisoners and made her own rules and made people uncomfortable, has been marginalized. And yet we need, you know, we need to know about these women, even though if they make us slightly uncomfortable, their stories are, they're part of the fabric of our history.
In reading West with the Night, her writing is so beautiful and descriptive of flying at night or of seeing the wildlife in Africa. And how do you explain that? She's an uneducated, unschooled person and never wrote anything else. Or did she write other things?
She did. She wrote stories, and she has there's a collection of her stories called The Splendid Outcast, which her biographer Mary Lovell put together. They're wonderful stories. She particularly writes to me when she blows me away is when she writes from the horse's point of view, both in West with the Night, and she does it again in a story in The Splendid Outcast. I think her genius as a writer comes from her ignorance. It's a theme. It's a theme. She didn't set out to write a literary book or to win the Nobel Prize, or she was trying to make some money. That girl was always trying to make some money because she didn't know how to take care of herself. I mean, she wasn't a practical girl. She was actually a consultant on a movie set in Hollywood on the movie Safari, because she was a kind of expert on Africa, and it sort of she was living on the West Coast, and somebody suggested to her that she met, like, wow, like, you have a really interesting childhood. You might want to write about it. And the first time that idea came up, she actually said, well, that's ridiculous. Why would anyone want to know my little stories? And then she fell broke for a while, and she's like, and who wants to know about my little stories? So I think she just started setting them down, and there is a raw quality. You know, there's a raw quality. Some of the work is very stylized, yes, you're right. But I think there's an unschooled feeling that's at the heart of it. It's very poetic. She really is just writing a love letter to Africa and to the great loves of her life, flying, horses, her dog, right? All she had to do was remember.
I'm over here.
Hi. Hi, Paula. Hi. I'm a pilot, so I was really grabbed by I was just grabbed by the first few pages when she took off and she's switching over the tanks and this very primitive aircraft. And, you know, you can just feel what's going on when she's, you know, spiraling down toward the sea. I just love the way you entered the book like that and then flipped it back to her life. That was brilliant.
Thank you. So that was just a compliment, no question?
Yeah, it was
beautiful.
Well,
thank you.
That was awesome. Yeah, I did have one short question, though. Whatever happened to her mom?
Well, I mean, her mother really did simply come back into her life in Nairobi 16 years after she left. And it's probably one of the ways that the book is most autobiographical for me. The way that I kind of leave it up in the air, Beryl was uncomfortable. She didn't know what her relationship with this woman was after 16 years. She certainly didn't need a mother by the time she was 20. And also, what I know from Karen Blixen's letters is that Clara was a rather helpless figure and a bit of a narcissist, right? Sort of came in and expected other people to take care of her. So I just sort of let that stand a little bit, the question of it, it's not resolved. It's never resolved, and I don't think that it can be. Certainly, it was never resolved in my own life either. So I just kind of let the puzzle of it stand. Like, who are you? You know, who are you now in my life?
She was a stranger anyway, but
yes.
Yeah. That was so cool. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.